are all products of evangelism in one way or another. If somebody had not left, where did the gospel come from to come to Africa? Is it just spontaneous, like this theory, the band theory? Gospel just landed. I'm sure somebody paid a price somewhere. There are people who left their country. There are missionaries who, out of the passion that was in their hearts, sought out to go out into the dark world then, just to be able to speak this love of Christ to the nations. And here today we are seated because somebody talked to us about Christ. You heard this message from somewhere, and you received it. You made a response to that word. And so we are believers in Christ today because of the enablement that God and Christ has given to each and every one of us. The Great Commission, should it be the Great Command? But if you look at the definition of that word, commission, it still means, you know, an instruction or a command, a role that is given to a person. I was just looking at the dictionary of what this commission thing means. It can also mean a group of people that have been entrusted by a government or other official body with authority to do something. And this is what Christ was doing, you know, having spent time with the disciples that he had. He was giving them something out of authority, an instruction in a direction that they can go and be able to do likewise, you know, making disciples of all nations and baptizing them. And there are a couple of things that he gives them a chance to be able to go and do, just as he had taught them and ministered to them. If you look at that Matthew 28, because that was our reference verse, maybe we'll just keep checking that with a few other scriptures. So, the conversation that was going on at that time. Remember, Christ had resurrected. And there was this tension of, has he resurrected? Where is he? And that kind of thing. And so as he meets with his disciples, they were in this state of awe. They were surprised. They were, this is the Christ. And after a moment of silence, Jesus actually decides them to speak and say that all authority, that all power, rule in heaven and on earth has been given to me as the Amplified Version. And he gives them this instruction, therefore, that says that go therefore and make disciples of all nations. Amplified says that teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you all the days, perpetually, uniformly, and on every occasion, to the very close of consummation of age. Amen. And so Christ was also making his affirmation that much as he was sending them to go out there, he was promising that continually he was going to be there presently, perpetually, uniformly, and on all occasions to be able to allow them to do this mandate and carry out the commission that he had entrusted to them as believers and as his disciples. And in terms of evangelism, just as Christ had walked a journey with the disciples that he had, even at this very moment, you realize that not all of them believe, because the Bible talks about, you know, some worship him, but there are those who doubt him. So it's actually possible that even for as many as exposed to this word of God and the gospel, some would still respond and give their lives to Christ, while some would still reach somewhere and be able to just say, I can't see how I can believe this. And that is a normal expectation, even as you go out evangelizing. There are those that will believe outright, there are those that will choose just not to believe at that particular moment. And so, these are the encounters that from time to time, as a believer, as you share out this love of Christ, you are likely to meet this. An instruction, and sometimes we then ask ourselves, have we been faithful with this command? Because when a command or an instruction is given to us, an expectation is met such that you as an individual, at a very personal level, you are able to take up that message or that instruction and be able to carry it forward. You are able to take it to the next level and actually practice it. You are able to put it you're able to put that which has been entrusted to you to work so that it is able to accomplish the task that is assigned to it. And so any other time then that we are not doing this, then in one way or another, we live in disobedience, because then it is not in conformity with the expectation of the authority that assigned you that same responsibility. The Great Commission is given for us for a purpose. It is meant to be for continuity. It is meant to be for generations to come. It is meant that for them that are with us in our generation, they are able to experience the same thing that Christ would so desire, a fellowship with God, a fellowship with Christ. And not just, you know, because out of that fellowship, there are many things that come out of it. You see, as a body of believers, even as we sit here this morning, yes, we are evangelizing and talking to people. You know, humans are going out to the street, evangelism come, they are going to talk to children, some are going to schools. You have the Sunday school team. That is a church that is coming up. I was in church this morning and you know, I saw some young children, they were running around. So I told them, you know, you are tomorrow's church. Because young as they are, there will come a time when some will be elders in church, some will be pastors, if Christ would not have come. And so it's a continuum of the same. And no soul is young. Even for those that are ministering to children, there are things that God is doing in their lives. There are people that have been spoken to and ministered to when they are very small, and they pick up the Spirit of Christ. And as they continue to grow, the Lord molds things in their hearts. The Lord begins to walk with them, young as they are, and later on, you realize their lives take a complete path that are able to reach nations, they are able to speak to people with authority, they are able to do the things that Christ so desired. So much as you're reaching out to these young children or whatever category of people, just know that as you evangelize them, you are making a deposit and you are making an inheritance for generations that come after us. We are here for a season, for a time. But when we are long gone, there are patterns that we form. There are things that we deposit in them as we speak and as we evangelize to them. We will go out of our way. You will make sacrifices. But at the end of time, the very things that we do, that we say, are able to transform many others that are beyond us. We minister to one another as a body of Christ. When we know Christ and you have a living hope in you, somebody who is undergoing depression, you can speak to them and they are able to find joy and hope and meaning in life because you have something that you are depositing to their lives. And so this Great Commission is such an honor, it's such a privilege that all of us have a chance and opportunity to be able to partake of it and to be able to go out and keep working it every day. Remember, Christ promises his disciples and even us today that he's there with us to the very end of age. On every occasion, in every circumstance, Christ is right there with you and is able to walk with you and be a blessing to you. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4, you know, talks about this desire that God has, that he wishes that all men be saved, and increasingly to perceive, to recognize, and to discern, and know precisely and correctly the divine truth. This is what is in the heart of God, that as we do everything that we do, as we sit here this morning, and as we have worshipped him, as we have loved the Lord our God, as scripture has been read, and you know, we have been encouraged, it is that we are energized in our spirit that as we go out of here, we continually have the reminder that we have a task that we have with us, that you have something that you can use to be able to reach out and be able to be a blessing to somebody's life. And so God so desires that all men be saved and that they would increasingly come to a level where they can perceive, they are able to recognize him, they are able to discern what he's saying, they are able to precisely and correctly, you know, come to know that divine truth that is of Christ. Salvation gives, you know, it's this I mean, all of us are given a chance in one way or another. And even as you speak to your friends, you give them an opportunity that they might make up their mind on that decision. And the Bible talks about, according to the Lord, a day is like how many years? 1,000. And 1,000 like a day. And sometimes God, in His own wisdom, gives men and women a chance, an opportunity to be able to repent and be able to turn to Him. And so you'll find that in life, the people who are very crooked in our own eyes, the people that we think are so wicked, the people that we think they are so unholy, the people that we think are so unclean, those are the people that God gives them time. That as they continually get exposed to God's word, they might find an opportunity and a chance to be able to believe in Him. And so never give up. You might be having this kind of friend or people that you talk to about Christ, and you are telling them, believe in the Lord, trust in Him. At times we go even to the extent of threatening them that you are a walking corpse because they have no life. And you know, our approach is different. Christ has given us love. You go to love these people. You see, one of the days, if you choose to walk out there, let's say that the Sisters Fellowship, let's walk to paradise. You know, commercial sex workers there. And you go there with a nice lasso and shuka and something, and you're like, you are great. You have some hope in you. There is something good about you. You will see how the love of Christ can break their hearts. And they will. Nobody can resist the love of Christ. Nobody loved and drawn close and embraced can resist the love of Christ. And so these are the opportunities that we have, that these men might be saved and have a chance to be able to walk a path that then they are able to know and discern the will of God, to know exactly why is it that they are there on earth. What is it that Christ has apportioned for them to be able to take a walk with Him and accomplish every purpose that is assigned for their lives. At the end of time and life, they will say, Lord, you know, we have walked this walk. You know, we have had a chance to experience you. We have had a chance to feed you. We have had a chance to be helped of you. And we have had a chance to minister together, just as we are co-workers in Christ. So God then gives us this ministry of reconciliation. And it emanates from the same principle of love as we are talking about. John 3:16, it's recited from Sunday school. But if you take in those words slowly and you realize that, you know, God so loved the world that He could even die for just one person. And that person is so special and unique. And we occupy that place this morning. You, first of all, as a believer, and then a chance to be able to go out there and walk a life of love, a life that can reach out to many others. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14. For the love of Christ compels us, because we are judged thus. Other version says, for the love of Christ controls and urges and impels us, because we are of the opinion and conviction that one died for all, then all died. And He died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for Him who died for them. It is the same power of love that Christ gives us. The ability and that urge, that innate desire, it is something that just is a part of you as a believer that keeps driving you, that compels you, that urges you on. There is something you need to tell somebody who's not heard about Christ. And this is the drive that is born out of that love of Christ. We are under the control of that power. We are under the control of that love. And once we perceive and understand this, then for us who live, you realize we no longer belong to ourselves. We live then for Him who died for us. We then live for a cause in life. And every other moment and every other decision is linked and paid to that kind of choice and decision. But then you want to walk this path of love with Christ as He walks with you every day, as He has promised that He's with us on every occasion. So it is this love of Christ that continuously pushes us on, that despite the challenges that we face, that sometimes even as you reach out there and as you speak to people this word of God, as you talk to them and they dismiss you off, we do not lose heart. We do not give up. We go to the next and the next. And every other moment and every other day, you go to prayer. You ask God for this mountain. You ask God for these souls, because then they are able to come and they find the warmth of His embrace. In Christ, we are all new creation in Him. The old spiritual person goes away and there's a new creation that is made in us. That new you has the ability, we can say you have the receptors to receive the messages of God, the will of God, to know the promptings of God. You are able then to discern what God wants out of your life. You are able to take a walk that is able to guide you into a fruitful life, even in Christ. And all things are from God, who through Christ has reconciled us to Himself. And it's brought us to harmony with Him and Himself, so that we are then able to minister to others this same ministry of reconciliation. It's Christ's desire that we might bring others also into harmony with Him. We have to begin with the first place of being in harmony with fellowship with Christ first, before we are empowered and given the ability to be able to go and seek to link others and bring them into harmony with the same Christ. You see, in life you cannot give that which you do not have. And for us who are believers, we have received everything. Everything we have, God has given to us. All the life we have, God has given to us. The forgiveness we received it freely from God. And then it is the same thing that we are at, that we can then go forth and are able to share the same message and be able to testify that this love that Christ gave unto us is working for us and is changing and transforming our own lives. Proverbs 11 verse 30, the Bible says that the fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and he who wins souls is wise. So, why do we need to evangelize? One, it's a mark of wisdom. And actually, you do yourself a favor when you win souls. It's a tree of righteousness. The Bible says that the fruit of righteousness is a tree of life, and he who wins souls is wise. So we have all this responsibility that we can actually go out there and are able to win these souls. Remember, heaven rejoices that every soul that comes to the kingdom, there are celebrations in heaven. Just imagine if you have a brother of yours who's been so drunk, who's been so reckless in his life, and finds Jesus and is broken and says, I've surrendered my life to the Lord, and begins to walk upright, begins to be loving, begins to take a path that is of honor and respect to himself and to others. What joy can that be even to you? And that is the same thing that we so desire, that our very own blood relatives, the way we desire good for them, should be the very same passion that we ought to have for every other soul next to you, as God gives you a chance. And God places you at a particular place at any given time and allows you to have an establishment of networks and friendships and relationships. I want even to challenge us. I know that even as we said this morning, you have these friends of yours. They are really good friends. But perhaps you've never told them about Christ. You've never challenged them. Hey, at the end of life, what do you think? Where would you be? There is this word you have heard from the word God. It can be a seed that as it grows, it's able to transform and change somebody's life. Jesus gives us an example, and I want us to turn to the book of John chapter 4. You know the story of the Samaritan woman. You may not read everything. But one of the things is that as Christ was walking through that land of Samaria, he was so tired. And maybe we can read verse 1. Let's go to chapter 4:1. Yeah, so therefore, when the Lord knew that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus met and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself not baptized, but his disciples, he left Judea and departed again to Galilee. So the thing is, you know, they had heard that Jesus was winning souls and baptizing more disciples than John, though it's again the disciples who were doing the baptizing. You see, as Christ comes to the end of his life on earth and gives the Great Commission, there are things that he was not asking his disciples to do, the things that he was not doing. Jesus, even from this example, was actually winning souls. His disciples went and did the baptism. And a disciple is a personal follower of Christ. That is what some versions and some definitions would give during his life, especially one of the apostles. It also mean one who follows, or a pupil of a teacher or a leader. A person who believes in the ideas and principles of someone and lives the way that that person does or did. And so when you are a disciple, there are things that then you begin to take after. There are things that you begin to pattern your life after. And so from every time that you think about yourself as a believer in Christ, we look at what Jesus was able to do. He gives us this example in John 4. And as he goes out there, they go by this well of Jacob. And he was so tired because of the journey. And as the disciples go to the town, you know, to find some bread and such kind of thing, this Samaritan woman shows up. She was coming to draw the water from the well. It was around the sixth hour, maybe noontime. And Jesus asked for a drink. And this Samaritan woman is shocked that, how can you, a Jew, ask a Samaritan, and a woman for that matter, for water to drink? And a discussion happens there with Christ. And Jesus, out of that passionate heart that he had, a disciple maker as he was, asks us, tells this lady, if you had only known and had recognized God's gift, and who is it is that saying to you, give me drink, you would have asked him instead, and he would have given you living water. And they go to have this conversation about water and thirst, and that you would have water that will quench your thirst, that you will need no more water. And so Jesus begins to have this conversation out of just sitting by the well. Of course, the Samaritan woman draws, you know, and brings to picture the traditions they had, the culture. That, you know, for us, we go to this mountain to worship. This well Jacob gave to us, his livestock, his children, even himself drank from it. And there are barriers that can be there, do exist even in real life today. But as we go out and we want to preach to people, they have come from a background of some tradition. They have come from a way of a certain culture, a way of doing things, a way of belief, a certain way of, you know, looking at what God is to them. Others worship mountains, others do things, others believe God is so good. At the end of life, even when we are doing everything bad we are doing, we will all be forgiven. See, so there are so many things that challenge the position that we have and believe in Christ. But Christ is able to bring the message and talks to this person. And with that kind of understanding, at the end of that kind of discussion, this lady is like, reach a point where Christ asks her, like, so, go bring your husband. And so, I say, man, the one I have is even not my own, isn't it? And so, Jesus, come on, dear, you have done well, you say the truth. And she gets into a state where she's broken because of that personalized message. Jesus was able to see, and because, you know, Jesus, being God, was just able to bring to light the nature of this lady and this woman, and told her everything. And she went out and said, come see a man who ever told me everything. You see, in our real life and every other moment, there are times that we miss opportunities to tell people out of love their actual condition, the state the way they are. Who can take somebody and tell them, my sister, I see, you know, this is who you are. But again, if you continue walking this path, it's so reckless, it might destroy your life. And there is a way God gives you grace to say and correct somebody or even share some light into a situation out of love and out of that passion. Because if Christ had not had love, then the most likely thing that you are likely to do as a human being is to judge. And so you can reach somewhere and you can come to a position where you can easily condemn instead of loving. You can easily, you know, put yourself in a class where we are the clean, holy people and you are the dirty, unsaved, and holy. And that is a dangerous path for any believer. Because then you block and put a barrier for yourself. Almost the same way these Samaritans had. We do things like this, we do things like this, we are of this. But when you are reaching out and when you are evangelizing, you must have a heart that is different, full of love, full of, you know, a desire to embrace, to share that word of Christ with understanding and with simplicity and applying it to the context of their lives. So this Samaritan then goes back to the village, gathers people. You can imagine the evangelization that one person did. She went and brought the whole village and town. Come see a man who ever told me everything I ever did. People hunger and thirst for God. People hunger and thirst for God. People yearn for someone to tell them something. People yearn to hear a word of hope. People yearn to be told that despite all that you have gone through, all the brokenness that you've ever experienced, you are not all done. There is still some good in your life. There is still some hope in your life. And there is still a purpose that God has designed that you can walk with Him and fulfill every joyful, loving thing that God has intended for your life. You see, the Bible encourages us in Matthew chapter 5, the Beatitudes, that, you know, blessed are they that hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. So it is us as vessels that God uses to hunger and thirst for God, for God's righteousness. Because then when we are filled in our lives, we are able to have the capacity to be able to boldly declare and go out and tell them, this is what Christ has for you, that Jesus loves you this much. It is when we commit ourselves as vessels to be renewed every day, to be built up every other moment, that we are developed and are changed and are transformed. In Acts chapter 3, verse 1, the story of Peter and John, you remember the beggar? That beggar was expected. There's something that he had hoped. Much as for him, it was some money, some silver and some things. But Peter and John, they had this culture of prayer. It was at the hour of prayer. They knew that this is the time to go and reveal. And as they reached that gate, they see this beggar. And they both of them looked at him intently. You see that eyeball-to-eyeball connection. And they saw that this man had faith. They told him, we do not have the things you are expecting. But what we have, we give to you. In the name of Christ, rise up and walk. And that power is transmitted. This beggar begins to jump, leap, and a life is changed and transformed. It emanated from disciples who had committed themselves to pattern their lives, to form a culture of prayer. That is where you empower yourself. You must have something to give every other time. And when a miracle happens like that, it becomes an opportunity for you to evangelize. You see, miracles happen any other time. And I know you are in medical school, but you can still trust Christ. Even as you climb that patient, as you examine, you can still say, God, may help this child. You can, you know, your hands, they can transmit some life. You can speak and encourage even that parent. Sometimes, you know, you do not just treat the children alone, but you look at the family, their mothers, their parents there. Speak to them words of hope. You are just not vessels that are walking and students learning, you know, getting knowledge to pass. You are a minister wherever you are. Every time, for those who are doing physiotherapy, as you are, you know, making sure the muscles are complying nicely, that patient is patient with you. Tell them a few words of hope. It can change somebody's life and transform them. Just as in Acts chapter 2, verse 37, Bible says when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" When in the life of a disciple, like all of us are, and I said, and I think you must also say that, you know, we are all evangelists in one way or another. It's a commission to all of us. There's a way when the Holy Spirit begins to work in your life, because this was after the Pentecost, and there was a transmission of that power. There was, you know, the Holy Spirit that powers your life. You're able then to testify, you're able to speak as one who has authority, and you can be able to bring light to these people. So the ultimate yearning for every soul is really to find relevance in life. Everyone so desires to have relevance in life, that before God, this life would be meaningful. This life would find a meaning. You remember the story of the prodigal son? They went, you know, squandered everything, but ultimately returns to the father's house. Everybody seeks to go back home. And we know that earth is not our home. We are passing through this time and season as God gave us a chance. But ultimately we transition. Everybody so desires that they find themselves be on the right path and be able to walk a journey that takes them to a place where they find Christ. This Samaritan woman, upon encounter with Christ, turns to be an evangelist. She brings people that which you have heard, go tell it to others. And many came, and they listened to Christ. And at the end of it, they said, "We have not believed just because you told us, but because they personally, at individual levels, they were then able to hear Christ for themselves and believed in him." We are changed so that we can become agents of change to others. We are loved so that we are able to carry the same love and pass it on to others. We are forgiven so that we are able to forgive. There are things that we, you know, God does for us so that we are able to be, we are enabled to be able to do this to many others. The harvest is always ready, the Bible says. The laborers are few. And as you pray that God raise laborers, at least pray and say that, "God, as we ask for more laborers, I'm available among them," so that you can be used in whatever way God has patterned and desired for your life. This kind of harvest begins with you, you know, having accepted Christ. In John 12:24, the Bible talks about that unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it only remains a single seed. But if it falls to the ground, it dies and produces many seeds. We have a chance in this lifetime that from the time that you have known Christ to the very end of life of your time and seasons on earth, ask God that you will just not die a single seed. But the very things that God has deposited in your life, they shall become of something to many other people before you die. Reproduce yourself. Multiply yourself. Our God is a God of multiplication. He's a God who works with us progressively. And that is why even as he invites us to go and make disciples of all nations, he says that he will be there with us constantly. Every other day, he's there with you. Let us be these vessels of change and commit ourselves that we can be changed and transformed. We are collaborators with Christ, the Bible tells us. And it's about his work. Sometimes, you know, we think, you know, we are working with Christ, but you cannot, as an individual, go out and do anything out of your own will and power and authority. We are enabled to do everything that we shall ever do in the kingdom of God. It is us to be there as vessels. When God calls people, he calls them to himself. He's using you just as that vessel. You have to prepare yourself. And these are the things that we do fellowship. We come to church so that we are strengthened and empowered. We exhort one another. We speak to one another that we have a course, we have a mandate, and we have a direction that we are taking on in life. If you look at the scriptures, when Christ was addressing his disciples, most of the time, he called them first to himself. You know, sometimes when a call is made, we sometimes think we just take up and run. And like, Gilbert, go ye. Most Christ called disciples to himself that he might make them. That's our process, isn't it? Then that he might send them. This making is what we do in fellowship, is what we do in prayer, is what we do in the study of the word. It is, there are the things that people preach to you, brethren, encourage you. You find some word that comes, builds up your life. He calls us to himself first before we are able to go. So that when he sends you with his power and authority. And so let us commit ourselves to these avenues and opportunities that then build us up. Finally, why do we need to evangelize? It is because it has a reward. Mark chapter 10, from verse 29 to 30, the Bible says, Jesus said, truly I tell you, there is no one, or most assuredly I say to you, unless, that's John. So Jesus answered and said, I say to you, there is no one who has left house, or brothers, or sisters, or fathers, or mother, or wife, or children, or lands, for my sake and the gospel's, who shall not receive 100-fold now in this time houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions, and in the end to come eternal life. Part of that package is very interesting. You see, persecutions is part of, isn't it? So sometimes don't get shocked when things happen to you. It looks like probably you are being refined so that you become a more purer gold vessel. And so, yes, you sacrifice brother, sister. What Christ was basically saying, there is a complete being sold out as a vessel. And surely there comes a reward. There are souls in heaven. They will be so grateful that somebody invited them to Christ. Their people will be forever grateful that somebody reached out to them. We shall be grateful. We do not know the first missionaries who landed at the coast. And those who were probably, unfortunately, were chewed by the lions. So they used to be the man-eaters. So maybe some even never reached their destination. But perhaps they told somebody a word in Mombasa before they came to serve. There are people who will be given because of the commitment and the devotion they gave. It has a sure reward. And so Christ calls us to himself so that he might make us. The work is plentiful. The harvest is plentiful. The laborers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest. As we pray, ask that God, you might be that vessel that you can reach out to a friend. That even in this college, for the time that you have, consider anyone that is your friend to make sure that you mention Christ to them. Invite them even to church. Sometimes it just takes an invitation to tell somebody, hey, let's go to the church this Sunday. That's enough. When God comes and the Holy Spirit begins to work, the word is deposited in that life. You begin to see somebody giving their life to Christ. There is a cost. We have to count that cost. Every daily preparation, every time you wake up, every time you sacrifice, every time you do the extra beyond the usual, there is a reward. It takes the Holy Spirit because it is Him that empowers us to guide us to be able to reach out and evangelize and tell people the truth about this Christ. You know the story of there's this missionary who was sent to the Hawke Indians. The story of Jim Elliot. And this missionary, I'm sure you've read her books about Elizabeth, his wife, and Jim Elliot. And Jim, when he was in college, because that is where he committed himself to that kind of preparation. He sought God, and he felt like he needed to go to that community out there in the bush and reach out and tell them about Christ. The passion in him was so much that even at that time, when he had this girlfriend in the name of Elizabeth, he was willing and saying, if she will not accept to go, it's okay, I will go. And so he prepared passionately. He sought, made friends. They prayed together. And after college, it was time for them to go to the mission field. And so they really worked with some mission organizations. Their story is very interesting. When they got married and they were young, and I think most of them just had a child or so, they decided finally it was time to go and live among that community. And so the day they landed, they went there, began establishing some friendships with them. And it did not take them very long. And one time, because it was a native tribe, they saw a photograph. And one of the daughters of that community had gone out to some oil companies and such. And so when they returned, hoping that, because that other little, you know, lady had gone and found Christ and such, and so was out of that native community. So they looked at that photo and they were like, you people are so bad. You mean you minimized our daughter into this small pebble? And they were very annoyed. And they killed all of them. At a young age, they were less than 24 years, and they just died like that. There's an elder who lived to tell the story of what they saw during that time, because it was in the bush. That elder testified that as they were killing them, and they killed all of them, in the trees, there were melodies, there were sounds of worship. And later on, that is what encouraged the wife, Elizabeth, to go back to that community and work with them. Remember, they killed their husband, but she loved them, worked with them, and translated their Bible to their native language. And that is passion and commitment that Christ can do. We all have a chance. And you can make an impact in life by simply obeying this call. Today, there are a lot of things that we do in life. We have missionary friends who are from Congo, and they are about to go back at the end of this year. And God gave us a chance just to meet with them and, you know, have a chance. And they have done some work from the time that we got to know them, somewhere in Baringo, very native place. There was no church, there were no people. I remember the first service we ever went, we were doing it under a tree. And they have loved that community. They now speak their native language. They have done like 13 years in that mission field. Today there is a church there, there are schools, and you can do anything when you can trust God and can be able to obey Osage. And God rewards and blesses their lives. They surrendered everything in Congo. One was an accountant at a university. The wife was a nurse. And they decided to come and live somewhere in the bush and serve Christ. God rewarded their lives. All their children, God schooled them. I think two of them went to Starea Boys. They were all schooled. Some are in France. Those are things God can do for you that you cannot do even with your own effort. Because when you faithfully commit to serve and evangelize, God takes care of your business. He protects them. He watches over them. They came yesterday to give thanks because they're about to go. As they came to church, we did a service, and we went. And unfortunately, they got an accident in Kerio Valley, they were going. But God preserved all of them. And they are fine. And God can watch over you even when persecutions come. There is something that is so special about that call upon your life. Do not waste it away. Choose to live passionately for Him. There must be something at the end of your 90 years on earth. Desire something. The people we admire, like Billy Graham, Reinhard Bonk, they began a journey somewhere. They chose to walk with Christ. They evangelized the world. You can also do it in your own unique way. You can pray, we will give, we will be available, we shall go out there. And begin with your Jerusalem. You can go to Judea and to the ends of the earth as God so enables you. Amen?
Amen.
This journey is relevant if you begin a walk with Him. And I just want us to close our eyes. And if you have not born again, one of the best gifts you can ever give yourself is to actually begin this walk and be obedient, to take a walk of discipleship in Christ so that Christ can make you. Remember, we've said you cannot give what you do not have. If you have never desired to know Christ, or if you have never committed yourself and make a declaration and say, I choose to walk with Jesus, this is an opportunity for us. And I want you to raise up your hand and pray together, even as we affirm and say the Great Commission is still so real. It is still, we are so invited. The invitation is still open. And that even we are challenged and we can go out there and we are able to do something out of this life that Christ gives us every day, that gift of life, to be able to reach out with love. But first, begin with this work, that you can accept that He loves you, that He passionately loves you, that all is not lost, and that even if you walked astray, there is a path that you can come back on the same course and say that, Jesus, I want to live right with you and walk with you, that this life may be so joyful and glorify your name. If there's anyone among us this morning, you want to give your life to Christ, just raise up your hand and we can pray together even as we pray. Anyone who has this? Okay. So shall we pray? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you and we give you praise and exalt your name. Lord, we thank you because you have spoken to us this morning, just exhorting and encouraging us. But Lord, as you give us this command that still stands even today, that Lord, we shall go out to teach nations, to make disciples of all nations, to obey everything that you've continuously commanded us, Lord. The things that you've given to us to believe in, that we may be relevant in our lives. That the desire of our hearts should be to know you more. That as we hunger and thirst for your righteousness, our cups are filled, God, that we can go forth and share the same love. A message of hope, a message of reconciliation, that men and women will be saved and come to a position that they can be able to discern you, God, that they may be able to walk with you, that they may be able to understand this divine truth that is has power to change not only our own lives, but also the lives of those that we go to. Oh Lord, we give you thanks. May your name be glorified. May your name be honored. In the mighty name of Jesus, we bless you and we honor you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let me just before we for whoever is coming. As a student in the year 2000, I went for commission 2000. The commission this year is it this year or? This is the year of commission. Please purpose to go for that missions convention. You will meet speakers, you will meet people, they might just evoke something in your life. And I remember as a student then, I didn't even have money to go, but somebody paid for me. And I was so grateful that somebody sacrificed. And I was able to go for that commission. The testimonies of the people that you get when you go for commission, it challenges your life to see something. I remember at that time we had one preacher who had kept doing missions in Southern Sudan. It was called Peter Hammond. And I was going to go to Sudan. And eventually, actually, when we finished school, we had a chance to do a mission to Southern Sudan. And it was so fulfilling. You should see what this message of love can do to people. Pick it up from there. If you have never went, and if even you have gone, this is another chance. If all of us can be commissioned this year, you can be sure you will be a better weapon of evangelism. Purpose, desire, where there is a will, there will always be a way out for you. Somebody will get money, we trust God will provide for you, and you can go for that commission. And every other time we have missions, support missions, go for missions. You work in our land in Koshua or something, some very difficult name. That wash. I think we really went, the rains were there, it was extremely cold. We did all the villages, I think. It's not even a village that we had to reach that we did not. And I think in heaven we will find a few guys, Kinanani Patrick or Kinanani, some young boys. So it's very fulfilling. Amen. Mungu awabariki, awapende, those who are doing exams, may not go with you, favor you, do your part. Don't panic.